So I was explaining to my colleague Yao, who was my colleague here in the math department, the fact that from physics it seems natural. This is before we conjectured mirror symmetry, that there should be as many Calabi-Yaus as positive Euler characteristic as negative one for Calabi-Yau threefold, which is a prediction of mirror symmetry. And he kind of found it very odd that we are saying something like this. And he asked, why are you thinking this way? I said, well, there's from physical perspective, it's natural because there's no natural definition of the sign of this operator. And you can choose either sign. There's no canon. There's no God-given choice. Therefore, different choices give you the opposite choices. And so therefore, from physics, reconstructing geometry will land in one or the other Calabi-Yau. You cannot distinguish which one. He said, well, that doesn't sound too right to me because we know more of negative Euler characteristic Calabi-Yau than positive. So there's no symmetry from the known example. So despite that, we conjectured it. So it wasn't like something was unintuitive. Something was against the mathematical evidence.
Right.
And nevertheless, we were so sure of it, we conjectured in my paper with Wolfgang Lerche and Nick Warner.
Yes.
So that's an example. And that later on, we had no non-trivial example other than six-dimensional tori. So non-trivial examples came later. The trivial example existed, but non-trivial ones wasn't there. But our motivation was basically simple examples and the general idea. But this happens again and again. So the things that fit together in some particular way in different physical ideas motivate a way of thinking which comes to a mathematical statement, which might sound strange to a mathematician at first, and now it's not.
Can you give one more example?
So examples of kind of math that a mathematician finds interesting or not. I mean, there are different kinds of things that mathematicians might find exotic. For example, let me go back to, let me say it before. It depends on whether you're interested in the content which is mathematical or the content which is physical. I will give you first the surprising physical content, which to a mathematician sounds strange. So if you explain to a mathematician that algebra or groups can explain why time dilates or length contracts, as Einstein's theory of relativity shows, special relativity, they find no connection between, you know, simple group of this and that, and this amazing fact that, you know, lengths contract and time dilates. For them, that physical reality does not connect with that other fact they know about, the group theory of transformations, which we call Lorentz group. So they understand one piece of it, but why that means the other one for them is a total mind-boggling thing. So if you try to say, no, this means that, and how does it mean that, and what does it imply, and what else it could mean, and so on, is shocking. And so, therefore, it depends on how you want to kind of package. Is it physically exciting, mathematically exciting, or other ones? But mathematical excitement, there are many examples. Other ones are, for example, mathematicians are interested in counting curves. Counting by curves, I mean how surfaces fit in some geometries. It's very hard for them to do that. Mirror symmetry was one way to actually do this. But regardless of mirror symmetry, we found, again, from a yet different physical reasoning, that the way these numbers are working conspire in a particular way to give you certain rational numbers, even though you're counting, they manifest themselves into a non-trivial rational number. This is something that my colleague Rajesh Gopakumar and myself found how to unpack these rational numbers to decipher integer quantities out of them. So we told our mathematical colleagues that if you compute this rational number that they knew how to in principle formulate, and if you do this operation on them, you can extract some integers out, which actually are counting some things. And for them, it was shocking. And they said, how, why, where is that coming from? Again, that came from understanding of these objects from physical terms. So there are many examples like this. Another example has to do with aspects of gauge theories. So we were interested with Witten in studying instantons for four manifolds. So this involves studying very non-trivial questions of geometry of bundles, gauge bundles or connections on which admit self-dual and considering self-dual gauge connections on them. And we were interested in computing on these spaces, the space of these instantons, their Euler characteristic. And again, from a physical reasoning, we knew that, or we were expecting that if you stack them up, instanton number 1, 2, 3, 4, they form a function. And this whole function has amazing properties, what's called modular transformation properties. So we said, we told mathematical colleagues that we are looking for this structure and we don't know whether these numbers are computable or not. And they were surprised that we are even looking for such a structure. And the first few examples that we found along these lines were already shocking. And now the math community, there's a lot of research trying to understand these invariants that we defined in my work with Witten. Uh-huh. So there are many examples like this, and I can go on and on, but I do not know whether that's within the range of interest of your listeners.
You just mentioned some invariant. What was its name?
This is, they call it now the Waffle-Witten invariance, but it is the invariance having to do with four manifold and instantons on them.
Yes. Also, when you're referring to invariance, the one about rational numbers counting them, that's called the Gromov-Witten invariance, if I'm not mistaken. Please explain, what are the Gromov-Witten invariants?
Gromov-Witten, actually, I should have said it. The rational numbers I was telling you is the Gromov-Witten invariance. So what we learned with, what we suggested with Gopal Kumar was how to unpack these rational numbers, the Gromov-Witten invariants, into integers, which is now called the Gopal Kumar Waffle invariance. That repackaging of that rational numbers in terms of integers was something that was surprising for mathematicians, and that's what we found.
You mentioned that there are self-dual connections, and I'm unsure, why is it that self-dual or anti-self-dual connections are so important? And is it only important in four dimensions?
Well, there are similar things in different dimensions, but the four-dimensional one, the self-dual connections are most interesting in four dimensions because the notion is really makes sense only in four dimensions. The dual of a gauge, the curvature of a gauge bundle is two-form only in four dimensions, so therefore it makes sense to say it's self-dual or not, only in four dimensions. The reason they are interesting is that they give you critical points of Yang-Mills theory, the minimum energy configurations in a given sector. So for each given sector, you can ask what is the... So first of all, the space of gauge connections on a manifold splits into different spaces. In each one, you can ask what is the minimum energy configuration, or in physical language, what is the minimal action configuration? And they end up being self-dual ones. So it's like a ground state of the gauge connection in that sector. Of course, in the trivial sector, the ground state means you turn off everything, gauge field is zero, nothing.
Yes.
But in the other sectors, you have to turn them on, and the self-dual ones are the ground state. So they basically are the ground states of the each configuration of the gauge connections. So having studying the ground states in each topological sector is, of course, natural.
Okay, so physics can be seen as a history of revolutions. I remember you mentioned this once, and one of the revolutions is that the constancy of the speed of light, or the Earth is not the center, or the solar system is not the center even. And then you said that the next revolution was, well, among others, but one of them is that point particles may not be points, they may be extended objects, aka string theory. Now, do you see there being another revolution that needs to occur within string theory itself?
Oh, it has to, because our understanding of string theory is certainly incomplete. We do not have, we just have pieces of what the theory is, not the full formulation of it. So yes, of course, there's got to be a better formulation of this theory. We have, I would say that what we have learned is the analog of the wave mechanics before we had quantum, we had pieces of wave mechanics like de Broglie had for quantum mechanics without having Schrodinger equation. So I think we are not there yet.
String theory promised a unified so-called theory of everything, but its landscape has proven far more rugged than physicists have anticipated. Some hail it as our best shot at understanding the universe, and others dismiss it as untestable speculation better relegated to the funding bodies of mathematics, not physics.
Well, obviously, if you knew the answer, you would be publishing on it, but you probably have some hunches. So what do you feel like is the assumption in string theory that may be overturned shortly?
Well, overturned is not the... I don't think we have something which is in the form of a laws of, like Maxwell's laws, that you can say this can be wrong or this can be right. String theory is a collection of examples of consistent solutions to quantum gravity. Those are not going to be overturned because we have all about them and they make sense. What we don't have is a unifying framework of what brings this whole thing together. So it's not something to be overturned, but something to be developed. I would say it's not that. It's like saying that how do you just to say the other way. Suppose you want to say how would you overturn de Broglie's wave statement? You don't overturn it. You basically develop it. You develop it to quantum mechanics. That's what string theory is right now.
Hi, everyone. Hope you're enjoying today's episode. If you're hungry for deeper dives into physics, AI, consciousness, philosophy, along with my personal reflections, you'll find it all on my Substack. Subscribers get first access to new episodes, new posts as well, behind-the-scenes insights, and the chance to be a part of a thriving community of like-minded pilgrimers. By joining, you'll directly be supporting my work and helping keep these conversations at the cutting edge. So click the link on screen here, hit subscribe, and let's keep pushing the boundaries of knowledge together. Thank you and enjoy the show. Just so you know, if you're listening, it's curtjaimungal.org, curtjaimungal.org.